These are upstanding. We'll sing number 235, Here I Am, Lord. It's in the booklet, or if you've got a hymn book, if you haven't got a booklet, then the hymn book 235. With Mr. Curtis playing the organ and Jean Tullin MacDonald. Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. Welcome everyone for funeral mass of Charles, Charlie, Cha, Gribbin, great witness to a well-known, well-respected man, his mother and father. Let's start at the top, his mother and father, Charlie and Annie Malone Gribbin, then one of seven children, Eddie, Mary, Betty, Pat, who died as a baby, Charlie himself, John and Peter, who's here today, head of the family, holding, standing proud, good memories and good, well-respected family in the parish and beyond. We met Helen and two children, Elaine and then Peter, and with Gary and Caroline, the grandchildren, Peter, Cara, Aaron, and Orla. The bare bones, Niamh, I think, is going to speak on behalf of the family later on. Those joining us through internet, very welcome, especially Joseph, Jopie Lang in Canada, and the family of Tom McLaren in Australia, and many others. to the member from the Boys Guild and just in life in general. Bits and pieces of our lives, like jigsaw puzzles, come together by our faith. They're these fragments of a life here, there, are brought together to the cross of Christ. And beyond the cross of Christ, the resurrection of Christ, that's why the Paschal candle stands lit at the head of the coffin. So let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves. Oh, sorry, just to welcome again those, if you're not a Catholic, please join in the prayers, the hymns as best you can. Don't get anxious. You know the family make everybody so welcome, so please feel at home here. Let us acknowledge our sins, cleaning our feet, acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves. Celebrate the sacred mysteries. Te confiteor, I think. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and my words, what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. Let us pray. O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Charles Gribbin, whom you have called to journey to you, and since he hoped and believed in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please sit for the readings.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord will destroy death forever. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all peoples and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever. The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth. For the Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our God in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us." The word of the Lord.
Say to the Lord,
With you, a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "It is not those who say to me, 'Lord, Lord,' who will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the person who does the will of my Father in heaven. Therefore, everyone who listens to these words of mine and acts on them will be like a sensible man who built his house on rock. Rain came down, floods rose, gales blew, and hurled themselves against the house, and it did not fall. It was founded in rock. But everyone who listens to these words of mine and does not act in them will be like a stupid man who built his house on sand. Rain came down, floods rose, gales blew, and struck that house, and it fell. And what a fall it had." Jesus had now finished what he wanted to say, and his teaching made a deep impression on the people because he taught them with authority and not like their own scribes. The Gospel of the Lord. Family chose the hymns as normal, as you know, favourites of Charles, and the reading that allows me a bit of latitude. My reading came from the readings for weddings, not for funerals, but I'll come back to that. I'd like to start with the family offered us that first reading from Prophet Isaiah, with quite strong words on this mountain. And if you look at it, it's all what God does, and this is what we've got to start. We've got to start and finish with to remember. It is God's work, first and last. The Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. This banquet in heaven is a foretaste already at Mass. We are already, if someone says, what's heaven like? It's really being at Mass, being able to receive Holy Communion. That's what heaven is like, a foretaste of the true reality of heaven. And then the Lord will remove the mourning veil, which we're about. The Lord will do this. The Lord will destroy death forever. Obviously, Prophet Isaiah didn't realize he was speaking truly, not just figuratively, because of the victory of Christ in, over sin and death as in his resurrection. The Lord will wipe away every tear from every cheek. Again, a lovely image for us. And we'll use it again in the third Eucharistic prayer. He'll take away his people's shame everywhere on earth. Power of God's forgiveness over our shame. So again, Mass is a, as well as confession, sacrament, reconciliation, Mass is a way of healing us of our even our attachments to sin. Who's got perfect motives? Who's got no blind spots? I know I have. So that's why we always look to the power of the Mass, the power of the sacraments, to free us from these things which poison our view and how we see things the wrong way, and this allows us to see God even. And the reason the Prophet Isaiah gives is, for the Lord has said so. So again, we're relying, that's where faith comes in, our response to believe the truths of our faith, the Christian faith, for the Lord has said so, and to stand on solid ground, for the Lord has said so. It's not human, mere human words, it's clothed in human words. It's actually the word of God addressed to each of us as a people, as a church, as a parish, but also individually, personally, for the Lord has said so. So it's God's work, his salvation. I'm not the Redeemer. Christ is, and that's why we're here today. We always come then to Mass with humility before the Lord. But the reason then, what does Isaiah say? We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us. So it's meant to be rejoicing. May not feel like it always, but to be of joy in our hearts, even in our trials and difficulties. For Charlie, he had latterly put to the test in weakness, and it's, none of this is easy for any of us. We like to talk about prayer being double when we're praying when we're ill, and that's okay, arm's length, but when we're ill, it's harder to pray, to trust God and say the prayers with great faith. But we're asked to do this. But the theory sounds great when you're not ill, you know, to say your prayers count double. But when you are ill, it's much harder for it to believe it and do it with sincerity and humility of heart, praying to God. The Prophet Isaiah that the family chose keeps clear it is God's work in us, his grace, his victory. Allowed me, therefore, a little bit more latitude, indulgence, even to take the gospel from the weddings. I'm not sure this is the one that was read at their wedding, but nonetheless, I just felt it was appropriate for a couple of reasons. Obviously, you know, the reading is a sensible man who built his house on rock. Rain came down, floods rose and gales blew and hurled themselves against that house, and it did not fall, you know, so it's founded in rock. And obviously with Charlie being a bricklayer, then he would know the importance of your works lasting the test of time. I think we're conscious of it just now because of this aerated concrete down, mostly down south, but elsewhere. So as a bricky, he would know this is important that your work lasts, because it's people's lives and livelihoods, you know. So it's not just, you know, a wee decoration that's on a shelf somewhere. This is people's homes, where they live and lives and work. So it's a healthy image for us, Jesus telling us to build a house well and not poorly. And there's a bricky when you build a house, it's brick by brick, and I think that sense you've got to be, small bits hold up the whole. I think that's a truth that brickies know. You know that each brick has a place, a part to play, and there's a weakness, then it will be found out. And that's why I think his team of workers, they were able to rely on one another. They knew they could rely on one another. And without looking over their shoulder and having second look at each other's work in their team, they knew to be well with each other and knew to have each other's backs. So that's it, that kind of thing. And as a Christian, our little bricks are just the small things of our lives, the little devotions that we have for Charlie's morning and night prayers, or like a brick, you place these bricks throughout your life and you'll be fine, the devotions we have. Helen was telling us she had to bless them with the holy water, which she liked to do, very simple things. These are small bricks. We've all got our own devotions, haven't we? Particular ones we've grown up over the years, particular prayers. Don't poo-poo them, they're bricks in a wall that keep the whole house going, the whole structure of our faith alive, our faith, hope, and love. So that's the second reason I chose this reading for the sense of the small bricks building up to a big house. It's lasts, obviously. For Charlie, you never even say, "Oh, I built that." The subtext obviously is it's still standing. I think that's nothing wrong with that. Pride in our work, nothing wrong with that. You're still standing. I did my job and it's still there. Nothing wrong with that. Taking pride. St. Teresa of Lisieux, she says, a rose saying, "I'm not beautiful, I don't have a lovely scent," it's nonsense. If you're good at your job, you're good at your job. And so don't, it's false pride to say I'm rubbish at your job. A lily, the whiteness of a lily, she says, no point in it saying, "Oh, I'm all bruised and battered," if you're not. That's false pride. St. Teresa of Lisieux has got a healthy understanding of true pride in our work and what we are about. And finally, the third reason I chose the reading, the gospel, is it's from a marriage, and obviously for Helen, her own marriage is something she treasures and lives by, bringing out her family. Anyone who's come to the house knows their hospitality, sense of welcome, and good neighbours as well. How simple things help the atmosphere in a little square or where you live. Whenever you have decent neighbours, simple things like leaving your lights on or whatever it is, the bike out in the rain or something, it makes a difference, and it's part of a family, a household that you're building with your wife, and obviously particularly for Elaine and Peter growing up in a loving marriage as a loving father and mother, a husband and wife. When we admire the houses, then it's good to see a nice house, but what we should admire most of all is the family and the strength of the family that's there. And yes, we make mistakes. I said at the start, none of us have perfect purity of heart. Sometimes we get it wrong. But the power of God's forgiveness for us is also celebrated today. The power of Christ and the cross, which won that forgiveness for us, we treasure by the five precious wounds of Christ that we touch and venerate, as St. Thomas did. Not those who say to me, "Lord, Lord," will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the person who does the will of my Father in heaven. Charles tried and knew, even his weakness, tried to do the Father's will, as Our Lady, as St. Teresa of Lisieux, as hopefully all of us here today. Heavenly Father, hear these prayers and petitions your faithful people place before you with humble hearts, and in our trials, our prayers count double.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That those who bear the cross of pain in mind or body may never feel forsaken by God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may deliver the soul of his servant Charles from punishment and from the powers of darkness, we pray to the Lord. That God in his mercy may blot out all of his offences, we pray to the Lord. That God may establish him in light and peace, we pray to the Lord. That God may call him to happiness in the company of all the saints, we pray to the Lord. That God may welcome into his glory those of our family and friends who have departed this life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may give a place in the kingdom of heaven to all the faithfully departed, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Close your eyes, please, and add one other intention in your heart. Do you know a situation or a person who needs the healing touch of the Lord? Heavenly Father, hear these prayers and petitions we make. Every hair on our head has been counted. We make these prayers through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please be seated for the offertory, and we'll sing number 317, Make Me a Channel, as the offertory is brought forward. my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Charles Gribbin, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful Judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for it is at your summons that we come to birth, by your will that we are governed, and at your command that we return on account of sin to that earth from which we came. And when you give the sign, we who have been redeemed by the death of your Son shall be raised up to the glory of his resurrection. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise, as without end we acclaim. You've created rightly gives you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts that brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave a chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is a chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Take a third one, please. The mystery of faith. Save us, Saviour of the world, for by your cross and resurrection. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognize the sacrificial victim by whose death he willed to reconcile us to yourself. Granted, we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain inheritance with your elect, especially the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael, the archangels, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you've gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servant, Charles Charlie Gribbin, whom you've called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your son in death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body, to our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life. Give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow in the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, forever and ever. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, or give us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. We await a Saviour, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will change our mortal bodies to conform with his glorified body. At spiritual communion, for those joining us through the internet, and for others who wish, if you're not a Catholic, if you wish a blessing, come forward. If you're not prepared, wish a blessing, if you cross your arms and come to me, I'll be able to give you a blessing if you wish. But at spiritual communion, Alphonsus Liguori, I, Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I can't now receive you sacramentally, come only spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to separate it from you. This is a time of great thankfulness for those of us who have received Holy Communion. We thank God for such a precious, precious gift. Also, in this context, maybe there's something about Charlie you always liked, a little episode of his life you want to recall. Just thank God for it in a moment, since all that is good comes from God. Let us pray. Please stand. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Charles may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Sit down again, please, as the pall cover comes off. Mother's taught them well, eh? So Neve's going to come and speak on behalf of the family just before she begins, just to say to congratulate the priests of St. Patrick's, the clergy of St. Patrick's, for attending to weeks and months.
Charlie was born on the 6th of December 1947 to parents Charlie and Annie Malone. He was one of seven children: Eddie, Mary, Betty, Pat, who died when he was a baby, Charlie, John, and then Peter, the Baron. When Charlie was a boy, he was an altar boy in Holy Cross, and as he liked to tell everyone, was the first person to carry the bambino round the new chapel when it opened in 1957. His brother John was also an altar boy, and he used to annoy John as he was allowed to swing the thurible, and John wasn't, and he would kid him on about this. In his school days, he won a prize for religion, when at St. Ninian's for reciting the Magnificat in Latin. His teacher didn't believe he had won and accused him of cheating. He made Charlie get up in front of the class to recite it, which of course he did and was word perfect. That altar boy knowledge paid off. Charlie was a talented footballer and played for the Boys' Guild at inside half. His brother John also played and they were very competitive. Although Charlie always said there were only three players better than him, Pelly, Jimmy Johnston and John. He was competitive off the park too, and on more than one occasion, the Subutio table was launched up into the air when the game wasn't going his way. He met Helen and they married in June 1971. They moved to Kosyth, but if anyone asked Charlie where he was from, the answer was always Croy. They had two children, Elaine born in 1975, and then Peter born 4 years later. Charlie was a bricklayer all his working life and had periods of self-employment, but latterly worked for Hart. He was skilled and precise in his work and took great pride in what he did. As he used to remind the family whenever they went to the Thistle Centre in Stirling, you know about this. After his retirement, he put his skills to good use, building a fantastic garden patio for Peter. He also loved gardening and would do both Elaine and Peter's gardens as well as his own, as he said he made a far better job of it than they did, and Elaine always got a hard time for not doing any weeding. While Charlie was skilled at bricklaying, DIY was not his forte, and nobody looked forward to being asked to help when he was attempting to build any flat pack furniture. Short on patience, it was never long before the shouting started as he lost the bag with it. Elaine and Peter remember the time when he was trying to plumb the new washing machine. This was not going well and made worse by the hot water hose slipping and spraying in the kitchen and their dad with hot water, much to their amusement, if not his. Charlie enjoyed many trips to Ireland with the guys from Croy, and on one occasion when Guinness may have been consumed, he rang Helen about 4 p.m, apologising it was so late because of the time difference in Ireland. Helen and Charlie have 4 grandchildren, Peter, Cara, Aaron and Orla. Peter played football from a young age and Charlie followed him all over the country supporting him, with Caroline as his chauffeur. There are too many stories to tell about them getting lost due to his dodgy road knowledge. He took great pride in watching and supporting Peter, and it was very rare if he missed a game. But if asked by anyone if Peter was a good footballer, as he was, he'd always laugh and say no. He too was very proud of Cara's achievements in her dancing, Orla's in her swimming, and Aaron too in his football. His grandchildren were the apple of his eye. Charlie's life was his family, and everything he'd done was for them. He was a much-loved husband, dad, father-in-law, and papa, and he will be sorely missed. The family would like to extend an invitation to join them at the Coachman following the service at Kosyth Cemetery.
Because God has chosen to call our brother Charles from this life to himself, we commit his body. We are dust, and to dust we shall return. But the Lord Jesus Christ will change our mortal bodies to be like his in glory, for he is risen, this firstborn from the dead. Let us commend our brother to the Lord. The Lord may embrace him in peace and raise up his body on the last day.
Present unto God the Most High. Receive. Listen to me.
We commend the soul of Charlie, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he committed through human weakness, and in your goodness grant him everlasting peace. We ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace, let us take Charlie to his place of rest. And as we leave, we'll sing 371, How Great Thou Art.
Thou art. That on the cross